Hey, how's it going, everybody? My name is John Wick, and this is an unreview. So what is an unreview? Well, basically, I have three rules when I talk about a product. Number one is I try to employ E-prime. E-prime is a linguistic tool that forbids the use of the verb to be. So I can't say is, was, or things like that when I'm talking directly about the product. So I can't say the product is good, or the product is bad, or the rules are crunchy, or anything like that. Instead, I have to say things like, I like this, or I don't like that. E-prime shifts the focus of the sentence from the object, which is what's being talked about, to the subject, which is who is doing the talking. In other words, in an E-prime review, I am the subject of the review. I am saying, I like this, as opposed to, this is bad. The second rule is that I have to like it. If I don't like it, I'm not going to talk about it. And I think that that's the worst, best review that I can give a thing, is if I don't like it, I'm not going to talk about it. But if I am talking about it, it means that I really do like it, and I think it's something that you might like too. And I'll try my best to kind of like show you why I like it, so that maybe you'll dig it too. And third, I have to have bought it. This is not something that could have been given to me. It's not something I won. No, I paid money for this. So if I paid money for it and I'm talking good about it, chances are, the fact that I laid out cash means that you'll be more likely to actually listen to what I'm saying. So those are the three rules. I'll try my very best not to use is, was, or anything else when I'm talking about the product. And number two, I like it. And number three, I paid money for it. So if those sound like, good qualifications for a review, let's get started. Now, back in 1989, I fell in love with a product called Torg. This is, you can tell my copy of Torg is very well loved. This is a role-playing game that came out in the late 80s, early 90s, and it tells the story of a reality war. Essentially, other realities have invaded our reality and are trying to steal our possibilities, trying to steal our energy. Possibility energy is kind of like the Force in that it creates possibilities in the world. And these invading cosms are trying to steal it. And these cosms are essentially their own kind of, they have their own rules, they have their own world laws. And there are things like Arorsch, which is this Victorian horror realm. There's the Nile Empire, which is a kind of like an Indiana Jones high adventure, high pulp technology, Flash Gordon type realm where you have archaeology and lightning guns. There's also a realm called Isle that's invaded England. That's all high magic. There's all kinds of stuff in Torg. It's kind of like Gamer Gumbo. If you like it, it's probably in there. I like Torg. I like it a lot. I think that the themes of Torg are very positive. They promote things like hope, and they promote things like solidarity, because our world is being invaded by an alien realities. Essentially, what that means is that our little petty squabbles, as important as they are to us, really fall by the wayside, and we've got to get together and stop the High Lords from stealing our reality and enforcing their own upon us. And that's Torg, and I have run a ton of Torg campaigns. I love this game. It's very popular among other game designers. And just recently, Ulysses Spiel and the people over at Pinnacle Entertainment have released a new version of Torg, and it looks like this 12-pound box full of Torg goodness. So if we're going to talk about Torg, we're going to talk about the box first. I picked this up as the $200 pledge for the Kickstarter. I do not know if this is going to be on sale anywhere at Gen Con or Origins or anywhere else or in any websites or anything. But if you can get your hands on this, I highly suggest you do, especially if you're a Torg fan. If you're a fan of high adventure, if you're a fan of fast-acting combat or systems, role-playing game systems, if you're a fan of heroic action in role-playing games, games that reward more than just murdering people who don't look like you so you can go through their spare pockets for change, Torg is a game for you. Let's take a look at what's inside, and it's 12 pounds. There's a lot. So we're going to start with the extra bits that are in the box. First off, there is a box of drama, essentially the drama deck. Now, this is not... There's a lot of games that have cards that add to the system. The cards in Torg don't add to the system. They are part of the system, and they are dynamic and fun. And what I mean by that is that when you play Torg, when an action scene starts, the GM starts laying out cards, the players start laying out cards, and the cards have a real influence on the game, and they make the game feel like it's... You're always on the edge of your seat because you don't know what's coming up next. So it helps create a sense of organized chaos in the game. Essentially, if you're going to be taking a prolonged task, for example, if you're defusing a bomb, the cards give you a time frame for when you can defuse the bomb. They also provide setbacks. They also provide complications. And the cards are not entirely in the player's hands or even the GM's hands. But there are things you can do, there are advantages that you can have, that you can manipulate how the cards play. So they create a strong sense of urgency in the game, which to me is a lot of fun. I can create a sense of urgency as a GM by just saying, there's a timer. But if I put a timer on the table and say, this is it, this is the chance that you have, suddenly that urgency becomes very real. And Torg does that with the drama deck. It also does that by creating cards that reinforce the cosm that you're in. If you're in the horror, the Victorian horror realm, there are cards that come into play that reinforce that genre, that reinforce the dread of that realm. But if you're in the Nile Empire, if you're in the high adventure, pulp adventure realm, there are cards that make you feel much more heroic because you can do the kinds of things that you see in Indiana Jones movies and Flash Gordon and all that kind of stuff. So the cards really add a sense of tension, they add a sense of genre, and they also empower the players to create subplots in the game. Now, when the game first came out in 1989, this is what impressed me most. It gave the players the ability to play a card and add an element to the story that I didn't plan on. And I know some GMs may feel that players shouldn't have that ability. But the way that Torg did it was so limited that the players could... when a player spent a card, it was a huge thing. As a matter of fact, there's a card that I love that has influenced me as a game designer and as a GM for my entire career, and that's the Martyr card. There's before a character takes an action, a player can play the Martyr card, and what it means is they're going to be successful at that action, they're going to be successful at the maximum effect of that action, as if they had rolled a critical hit, for example, but they're going to die doing it. And I have seen players hold on to that Martyr card for weeks, waiting for the right opportunity to use it. And nobody knows they have it because it's in their hand. But when they play it, the whole table lights up because it's that moment of self-sacrifice that means that character, that player gets to save the day. But their character dies doing it. It's that kind of thing that was built into Torg, into the cards, that really made it special. Now, other elements that this box comes with, it comes with a pack of poker chips for possibility points, because players can manipulate possibility energy because they're storm knights in the world, and makes them special and unique. So, we have... and by the way, the poker chips are shiny and they're just really nice poker chips. The game also comes with a whole ton of tokens. It comes with three sheets. I was going to grab it. I might as well. It comes with four sheets of tokens, which I have punched out. And again, something that I really like about the design here is that the tokens are utilitarian. They're very useful to me. They allow me to do things like, say, you have taken a wound and put it on the character sheet, or you are in this phase of your extended action. They also have tokens for a lot of the antagonists. So if you want to use a grid, and the game does have rules for using movement and using miniatures, which we'll get into in a moment, if you want to use those rules to help you guide your way through a heavy action scene, you can use these tokens to do it. I'm very happy with these. And speaking of that, here is the miniatures in the game. Now, as a game designer, and as someone who's published many games, miniatures are expensive, and they're difficult to you have no idea how difficult miniatures are to do if you haven't tried. And what I like about this is that these are the miniatures in the game. They are cards that have standees that you can put on, so you can use these and move them around the board. And I like that there's a front, and the front has all the stats that the players would engage with. And the back is all the stats the GM would engage with. That's very cool. I dig that a lot. And there's a whole ton of them. There's a whole deck of them. Again, really useful for a GM. And if you are not using this kind of technique in your game, and you don't want to, you know, get into the huge hobby of painting miniatures. I love miniatures so much, and I'm so bad at painting them. You know, using standees is a really good, inexpensive way to have miniatures in your game without all of the preparation that they require. I highly recommend using miniatures in your game, if nothing else, to say, this is my character. This is what my character looks like. That makes my hair stand up on the back of my head. The game also comes with a soundtrack of ambient music. I've already downloaded it on my Mac and plan on using it. It's evocative and subtle, and that's the kind of music that I want in a game. I don't want music that players are going to start chanting along with, unless they're in a tavern with sea shanties, in which case might I suggest the Songs from the Seventh Sea CD. Yeah, it's a blatant plug. Sorry about that. But this music is ambient, and it is subtle, and it is evocative. Good balance. I like the balance of that. And so anyway, this also comes with the package. Now, we've talked about the, let's call it, software that came involved in this, all of the goodies. Let's talk about the actual books. So here's the core rules. It's 280 pages. It comes with two ribbons, or red ribbon and a blue ribbon, because that's the color that reality storms take. And if you're interested in Torg or know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about. The book is full color. Like I said, 280 pages. The layout was very easy for me to read. The way the book is divided into things, I turned to one of my favorite pictures. We have a similar picture in 7C. And I always tell people, the person who's in charge in this picture, who's in danger in this picture, is the shark. Because this is Torg. But anyway, hardcover, gloss cover, like you can see. I really like this book. I like the way the book is laid out, and I like the way that the rules are presented. I'm an old school Torg fan, so the way that the rules were updated to a 21st century mindset, really, a lot of the changes I liked. As a matter of fact, I can't think of any of the changes that I didn't like. There are little things that I didn't like about the original system. For example, this original system uses a d20, and that's a bit too swingy for my taste. If the dice have more effect on the outcome of my action than my skills do, that's a system that I don't like, because I want my character to have more impact on my success or failure than the dice do. I want the dice to modify my stats, not my stats modify the dice roll. And again, that's something that I like more. I know a lot of people like randomly rolling in the wind. That's up to you. That's a 31 flavors of ice cream question. But for me, that I like that more. So in the new Torg, not only... Oh, I forgot to show you the dice. So in the new Torg, they do use a d20. Here's the storm die. Yay, the return of the storm die. I could probably go pull my original out of my dice bag. I keep it there for good luck. But the game also uses d6s as bonus dice. So now when you roll a d20, you're also rolling a d6 or two, and that modifies the roll a little bit more. It evens out the bell curve a little bit, and I like that change. I like that change because it means that rolling more dice means that the outcome is less random. It's easier to tell which side of the curve it's going to show up on. And for me, That's a bonus. The game also has a few things. It has advantages, which the game did not have before. And the advantages also allow you to control more of the outcome of your actions. I like that. I like that I get more control in the game, because the game, as far as I'm concerned, when I'm playing or running a role-playing game, the GM is helping the players tell the story of their characters. And I want them to have more input on that story than the dice do. The dice can have an input. The dice can essentially help us determine when we don't know what's going to happen next. But when I do know what I want to happen next, I don't want the dice to tell me no. So there we are. So the system helps push that a little bit more forward. There's a little bit more narrative control for the players. And essentially what happens is that you roll a d20 and you take a look on a chart, and the chart gives you a bonus, and the bonus is what you add to your stats to overcome a target number. Very simple, very clean, very easy. One die roll tells you a lot. And I like that for an action game, because that's kind of what you need. There's a book of, is this 12? 12. 12 adventures in the book, in here. And they are written by some very, very recognizable names, mainly because Torg is so popular among game designers that everybody wanted to jump on it. I don't know what the right phrase is, because I can't think of it, because I'm kind of speaking that word. One of my adventures is in here, and I'm very honored to be with really prestigious names along in this book. I've read all the way through the adventures. The adventures are fun. They're short, so they're one-shot adventures, so you can pick it up and play it in one night, or extend it if you want to two nights. But the adventures are very short, and they all create difficult decisions for the players to make. Also forgot to mention the GM screen. This is the GM screen. First of all, it's a big, hard, thick GM screen. That's always to my liking. The inside of the GM screen is really useful to me, because it has all the things that, all the nuanced elements of the game. There is a small bit about difficulty modifiers and things that are handy, but the nuances are what's important to me, because Torg is a game about nuance, and the little things can make big differences. The GM screen has those little things in it to remind me of when I should use them. And that's why I like it, because it does contain those little nuances. Now, the next book is called Day One. And this is the very first day of the war, the very first day of the invasion. And it has 7 adventures in it that carry you through the first day of the war. Adventures in here set up a huge campaign for you to run. If a lot of times when people read Torg, they're like, I love the setting and the system is really simple and easy, but I don't know what to do. It's so big. It's so big that I can't find a starting point. This book gives you that starting point. This is a brilliant idea. I wish I had thought of it. But it falls firmly into those I wish I had thought of this ideas. I like this book a lot, and when you get done reading it, you will know what to do with your Torg campaign. And then there's a couple more things in here that I want to talk about. First off, well, we're done with all the books, but here is the character packs. There is a pad of character sheets, of one-page character sheets. That's very handy. They're all in full color. However, it also comes with character folders. And what that means is that this is a 4-page character sheet a 4-page character sheet. You know what this is for. Good stuff. I like it. And finally, oh, wait. No, there's more. There's the maps. The box is endless. The maps, there's 2 maps, and the first map is the Day One map. Can I talk over here? So this is the map of the invading cosms. Over here you can see where each of the cosms is invaded. And this is the first day of the war, so this allows you to start right there where the cosms invade. And the second map is essentially the same map. However, it's year 1. It's the first date, or is it day 9? No, it's day 90. That's right. It's the first 3 months. And here you can see how the cosms have expanded over the first 3 months. So if you want to start at day one, you can start right there, and you've got a map to help you sort things out. If you want to start in day 90 of the war, then you can start here as well. And then finally, this is something that I really like. So each of the cosms has its own world laws. It's almost as if each of the cosms is like a game unto itself. Use all the cosms using the same rules, but using different iterations of those rules with unique situations. And so here is a standee for each of the cosms and each of the cosms' world laws. So for example, where's the one that I've been using? Ah, here it is. Here is the cyberpapacy. And by the way, the cyberpapacy, I've said on many occasions, is the scariest horror setting that I have ever seen in a role-playing game. A lot of people don't get that, but when I say it to them, they're like, oh, yeah, it really is. The cyberpapacy is the 13th century Catholic Church, full of all of its witch-burning and its Inquisition and all the horrors of the Catholic Church in a cyberpunk setting. So, if thy hand offend thee, cast it off and replace it with steel, because steel has no sin. That's scary. It also includes things like faith chips that get embedded in the back of your head. And, it's lots of really awful things. So each of these standees is what you can use at your table. And you set it up like this. And so there's a front and a back. And this has the cosm levels for each of the different cosms. There is a magic level, which is how much magic is in the realm. There's social, which is kind of abstract, but it's really neat. It's the idea of, does democracy exist does the idea of democracy exist? Does the idea of tribes exist? You know, those social ideas, do they exist in this realm? Because if they don't, then they don't. And the social level kind of says that. Spirit is miracles, and finally, technology is what you'd expect it to be, technology. So what happens is if someone tries to use, if a core Earth person, like you or I, brings an idea or a technology into this cosm, and it doesn't fall under the rank of these ideas, it causes a contradiction in the realm. The cosm itself says, hey, you're not supposed to do that here. And there are consequences, and sometimes dire consequences, for what happens next. And it's, again, that's another thing that I really liked about Torg, is that it's a game that has real consequences. Players' actions do not happen in vacuums. And when they take actions that are extreme, or they take actions that get noticed, that should get noticed, they do get noticed, even if it's just by the cosm itself. So those are those. And then it also has the world laws. So for example, the law of the one true way, religions other than the cyber church are contradictions. So if you are part of a cosm, for example, like from the living land, which is, the living land is kind of like a mashup between Land of the Lost and Thomas Covenant's The Land, in that the idea that living things are sacred. And there's dinosaurs and ancient stuff going on over there. And there's also a lot of lost, like, people get lost in the living land and in the mists of it. And you can find a wrecked spaceship there because other cosms have interacted with it. And because the technology level is so low, they cause contradictions and just fail. So if you bring the religion of the living land into the cyberpapacy, and you try to use any of the miracles from the living land, you cause a contradiction. And again, that can have dire consequences. Also, the cyberpapacy works on the law of suspicion, which means that nobody trusts anybody else. The Inquisition is everywhere. And these are on the table. This is something that, as a GM and as a game designer, I'm always looking at ways to do, is to put things on the table. I don't remember if I said it to him or if he said it to me, But Jess Heinig and I were having a conversation once, and the phrase, if it's not on your character sheet, it isn't real, came up. And what that means is that if exactly what it means, if it's not on somebody's character sheet, it's not real. It doesn't matter. Well, here, this is on everybody's character sheet because it's on the table. And everybody can look at it, and everybody can be reminded of it, especially you, Mr. and Mrs. GM, because it's right there. And it's an easy reference, but more importantly, it's that timer that I was talking about earlier, sitting on the table. It's there. It's real. And the consequences of this cosm are always present and always in mind. This is my favorite thing from the entire box. These things are really, for me, a way to impose the reality of the cosm onto the players in a real way. Really good job, guys. Really good job. And that is the bottom of the box. There is nothing on the bottom of the box. I'm not disappointed because there's so much in the box. And that's Torg. That's the new Torg. Like I said, it cost me $200 to be a backer on Kickstarter and maybe more. If it is, and if what I've pitched to you sounds intriguing, you should try out at least the core rulebook. You should give it a try, because Torg is one of my favorite role-playing games for the reasons that I've said. I love the idea of an action-adventure game that takes on the metaphysical question, what is real? And can we steal reality? Can we impose reality onto other people? I love that idea. I love the idea of hope that Torg has. By the way, our cosm, our core Earth, also has a world law, and it's the law of hope. And that's just, again, it just makes me feel, yeah. So anyway, I love Torg, and I highly suggest you get a copy of the Torg box set. Look there, it's the symbol of the Delphi Council, which you'll learn about if you get Torg. Go get it. Go get it right now. It's fantastic. I like it a lot, and I think that you should have it too. And that's my unreview of Torg. I violated a whole bunch of my E-prime rules, but hopefully I followed them up with reasons why I say things like, it's fantastic. And because I'm speaking extemporaneously, I got it right this time. They'll slip out every once in a while, but I'll get better at this as I go on. If you want to see me do more unreviews, hopefully I'm going to be doing these once a week. If you want to see more, click like, make comments in the comments section. Please leave constructive criticism and don't be a dick. And also share it with all of your friends. If you really like the idea of Torg and you wanna pitch it to someone and you think that this is a good idea to get your players to try it out, send them this video and hopefully I'll be able to convince them as well. So share, like, and if you like what I keep doing, hit subscribe. And thank you for getting this far into the video. We'll see you next time for another thing that I really like and for another unreview. Take care. Have a good weekend.